Captain MacTaggart?
He's away to Pollock Shaw's for his mother's funeral. He'll not be back for a fortnight.
We'll wait.
John, you're looking at something.
When do you know it's a wee boy to pay?
There's only get something to
do.
Come on.
Aye, son. They tell me the truant officer's after you for going to sea before you'd finished with the school.
It's not true. I'm over 15.
Oh, well, you'll be able to finish your schooling now. That old puffer will not be putting out again.
She will.
Ah, it's high time Peter MacTaggart was put ashore. He's no fit to manage a rowing boat.
You'll not say that about the captain.
Captain him?
Come on.
The wee devil. Only 3 months out of school and he's as big a rogue as the rest of them.
Yeah, you said you were in this fight.
One of the assistant directors, he was out looking for a boy. They tested one or two by that time. And
they
weren't suitable. Couldn't have been anyway, but somebody must have told him at the gang show there was probably 50 boys in my age group that could have been picked for that.
Yeah.
I was working backstage. My old scoutmaster was in charge of the questions.
Right.
An old pair of dirty white overalls, and I was...
You just must have looked right straight
and the Kings, well, we were working below the stage there, it was a dirty, filthy place, you know?
Yeah.
And I must have looked the part, the hair must have looked like that, and a dirty face, and all the rest of it, so... They took my name and address, and that's the usual thing, yeah. Thanks, you know? Didn't stop going to the part, you know?
That's amazing.
I just sent a telegram to along the script to get in and do a test.
Right.
And then I did that, a few days later, the telegram again, and then I had the part, you know?
Yeah?
So that was the beginning of the week, probably that Tuesday, Sunday, we were in a car heading up here. That was May 1953.
53? That was the year before I was born. Exactly a year.
We arrived there on a Sunday. Monday we got back up to the Crinan Hotel again where the main body was. We got me dressed up in the gear I was supposed to be wearing, and I thought, well, this is quite good stuff, this. I'll be hanging on to this lot when I'm finished. Then the producer come along and started cutting holes in the jersey and things like that. Finished up, he had me rolling about in a coal hill to get dirty, to make it look dirty. I thought they were all mental.
Is that just by the canal?
No, just up at Crinan, at the Crinan Basin. We were billeted and we arrived on Sunday at Crinan, wherever they were sort of meeting. But my mother and I, she was with me. We were billeted at the Cairnban Hotel, a few miles back down the road again. But the Monday, as I say, we went to try on all the gear, and this guy started cutting holes in the jumper and pulling stuff about and got me to roll about in coal and coal dust. The place is still there at the Crinan Basin yet, 50 years later, but I thought they were all mental. They were all with the stuff that were just wasting it, and I had nothing to start with. But anyway, that was what it was about. To look scruffy. I must have looked the part anyway. But that was the silly bit about it. And that was when they'd built all this pier at Crinan at the same time. And it was all brand new wood, and they just finished the building it. And they started to make it look old and dilapidated, so they started breaking the pier up after building it all to make it look, as I say, ancient. which is the way it was seen in the film, because it all broke up eventually with the puffer running into it. But that was in the... There's a big load of stagers and joiners and, you know, chippies, as they call them, at the working there at Crinan at the time. And I think it must have been the Tuesday or the Wednesday when we actually started filming. Did the portion sequence, that was the start of the film. We actually went back down to Cairnban and started shooting the poaching sequence, Jimmy Copeland and I. That eased me into it, because I wasn't the slightest bit embarrassed in front of cameras, because it was just sort of fun and games. You were a distance for the cameras at the time, and it was just Jimmy Copeland and myself were doing the first few scenes, you know. And you get used to the crew, you get used to everybody around about you, and you get especially used to the van coming up with the tea and the buns and the rolls and stuff like that. You got that, you watch for that all the time. You got the lunch and tea breaks and that were delivered, and maybe the van there, you know, the canteen van. As I say, within a few days I got to know everybody in the place, and they all got to know me. I was never shy in company, I must admit that. I was never ever shy in company. But we all got to know each other, and I got on well with everybody after that, and we just worked away filming. Worked at Crinan, must have been for about 6 weeks in that part of the country, and then we moved over to Ealing. Probably another 6 weeks there. Something like that. Then we stopped for a wee holiday. And I think we had some work to do in Glasgow, and then we went down to London, down to Ealing Studios, to finish the film down there. Well, that was the pub sequence. That was Dirty Dan's. Pub called, there used to be a pub at Finiston where that was supposed to have happened, called Dirty Dick's. But they called the pub in the Maggie Dirty Dan's. That was when I got thrown out of the bar. And that happened with a turnip. It was a turnip that had been boiled up and scooped out to soften it all. The mash had been put back in and softened it up. This as well, because they knocked his bloody head off of it. It had just been a turnip out of a box. That was Dirty Dan, Jimson Clark. Jimson, that was when I was a hooligan, I was fighting in a bar, 15-year-old fighting in a bar.
Did you take it in one take?
No. I threw the first turn up, and I just hit him in the shoulder before it hit him in the face. And I did another take, and it was a prop man, like Wally, he threw the second turn up. I think it was the second take, that was it, just the second take. Wasn't there very many multiple takes in that film, if I can remember right? One in particular, I was supposed to be, as the boat hit the subway, I was supposed to fall on the deck. And Sandy McKendrick, I don't know why, he wanted it done a certain way, and his hands were all twisted. That was how he tried to explain things by doing this. But at the end of the day, when I saw the bit in the film, and I was supposed to fall on the deck, all the ways he wanted me to fall, it never happened. He just saw a kind of figure falling on the deck. That was it, and the boat hit the subway tunnel.
How did you get on with the other actors then, Captain McTaggart and...
We got on great. We got on well. Jimmy Copeland, Alec McKenzie, and Alec was a teacher, an ex-school teacher. He wanted me to learn to sing in Gaelic. I was quite a good singer then. I still had a bit of the boyish voice, and I could sing well, and started teaching me one or two wee songs in Gaelic, but I couldn't get into this. I was being Lowlanders, the real Sassenachs. We call English people Sassenachs, but it was the Lowlanders. We were Lowlanders. Coming from Glasgow and places like that. Anyway, I wasn't into this he drum ho stuff, as we called it, the Gaelic. I didn't want to be bothered with that. I was into the pop songs at that time. But I'm sorry now I didn't, because I could have learned a lot from old Alec. Could have probably been able to speak Gaelic by this time. That's something that a lot of Scottish people, I don't suppose, are very proud that they can't even speak their own language, you know. Oh, we got on well. Alec, as I say, was his teacher, and I suppose he knew, he was teaching pupils, and he knew how to talk to me, and they never talked down to us or anything like that, no way. But Alec and I, we could talk away to one another, and Abe was a quieter wee guy, really. He was all right, he was always funny, he was a lot of funny things, and you'd see a lot of funny things. I mean, he'd been at that game for a long, long time. Jimmy Copeland, Jimmy was just your mate sort of thing. Jimmy was a good guy, and we all got on well. Hubert Gregg, when he was up doing the poaching sequence, and he went away and he had to come back again for something. And it was, we were all friendly, great to see him back again. And I remember Jimmy Copeland, myself and Hubert, And it might have been somebody else, I can't remember. Seems it was four of us in this rowing boat anyway. We knew for a wee row in this boat anyway, just round about the Crinan Basin there. Not the Crinan Basin, just outside the main lock. We went a wee boat for a wee sail there and they made reference to. I don't think he was long divorced. Was it Pat Kirkwood? I think it was his wife at that time. I don't remember.
Paul Douglas.
Paul Douglas. He was a wee bit more for the men and I. He liked his booze, Paul Douglas. His wife, Jan Sterling, was there for the first two or three weeks. She came up. She was there at the time of the coronation. Because between them, they bought me a box of fireworks. Geoffrey Keane, who was in the film, she was his secretary. Anyway, she baked me a cake, brought it onto the set, which I thought was, well, it was great, you know, terrific.
How old were you then?
I was just turned 15, it was my 15th birthday. And Sandy McKenna came up and gave me a wee bit of paper. This entitles you to one bicycle for your 15th birthday. So I got a bike for my birthday and you saw photographs of the bike and all that. I got that and I got this birthday cake and everybody round about wishing me a happy birthday, the extras and everybody. It was during the sequence of the office, we met Pusey in the office, and that's when he took us on under false pretenses to carry this cargo to start. I can't remember what Geoffrey Keane's name was in the film, but he was a big shot, ship owners, you know. That's when we took Hubert Gregg round to see the boat. He mistook it for, I think that was a ship called the Hebridean, probably scrapped years ago. But we were in behind it and away down below it, and Hubert Gregg took this Hebridean to be our boat. So we never made him any the wiser. We wouldn't have got the job anyway. That was the cheating started.
So I've been instructed to make certain that the ship is perfectly sound. I see no cause for concern on that score. Shall we go back to the office? Or better still, if we could settle the matter here.
Aye, that's a better idea.
But, we're way off on a tangent again. I was talking about birthday cake.
Yeah, no, it's all right. Since we're on that subject, was the office bit, was it shot in London?
I was at Ealing, shot at Ealing.
So when you came out and went to look at the wrong boat, that was here?
That was at the Kingston Dock, which is closed in now, it's all...
In Glasgow?
That was in Glasgow, aye, just straight up the river there.
Aye.
That sequence in that office, when we were in the office looking for work and we come across this daft Englishman with a bowler hat on and all that, you know. When we left the office, I stole a pen. That was part of it. Quite a few people wrote in about that. That's terrible, having a boy like that, you know, making out that Glasgow boys are scruffs and they're crooks and all the rest there.
Where is the boat lying?
Only a couple of hundred yards down the road there.
I don't mind, I think I'll just take a look at it.
It was just a wee bit that Sandy McKenna thought would be good to put into the film, you know.
So you went to Isla as well, is that right? Well, to do that bit with where there's a church at the top of the hill.
Beaumont,
right.
Beaumont, the round church. That's so the devil can work in corners.
Oh, is that right?
An old Highland superstition as far as I remember. We did Beaumont. Sailed to Oban, sailed to Tobermory in Mull.
Did you film on Tobermory in Mull?
No, it's off. We had to get in there at night, we were doing stuff off the island. Two boats, a second unit, and there overnight. And the weather was... in there. The weather was bad, I think, and we decided rather than go back to where we started from, we were going to Tobermory. First scenes of the film were made along at Cairnban, along the road there.
All right, right. Oh, yeah, yeah.
When we die.
Yeah.
And you see me running along the track with the pheasants. This is well on in the film, isn't it?
Yes. Halfway through, yeah.
Running along the track with the pheasants and coming onto the boat, it's after the boat, coming onto the boat just that log there.
Yes, you jumped on it, didn't you?
Well, that's me. I ran 6 miles that. I'd love to be able to run doing it.
Oh, now, yeah.
Good to go.
Where's Mr. Pusey?
I don't know. He shoved a lead in the canal.
Whose idea was it to come out with the little catchphrase?
What was that?
Good luck to you.
Oh, that was Sandy McKendrick, probably. The director, yeah.
Yeah.
I good luck to you.
Because it just makes a film at the very end. At the very end, the closing, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
The boy was the main one, I think it was the second unit sort of thing, you know.
So it was one of them at Glasgow, one of them at this end?
No, not really.
Isn't that how they did it?
See, they were both up here, I went to. Two of them are tied up alongside one, and they're just here. He's forgotten the picture, he had a picture of it.
Oh, that's yeah.
No, he's forgotten it. They were tied up alongside here, I think it was the only picture of the two of them together.
Well, it
was taken by a young lad that lived in the area, you know.
Oh, right.
I met him years later, the place I worked in.
Right.
And he told me about this place and brought it in and gave it to me, you know. For this, and that was the Lochmora bar.
Oh, that was the bar. Yeah. So how did they break up the pier when it? I mean, did the boat actually break it up, or did they didn't ram it or anything? Just
the boat smashed it in the film.
Yeah.
That was part of it, you know, I suppose we spotted it, it was catching under the pier, you know.
Yeah.
So they were coming to take the cargo away in a bigger boat and we were losing the job.
Yes.
And I twigged.
Yeah.
The tide comes up, going to catch under the pier and it's going to cause damage.
So it actually did it?
Aye, they rigged it up with kind of slings and things as well.
Because there's a bit where he's...
started pulling it out and it backed against it and it all you know.
I mean, sir, if you left her the way she is, and the tide come in, would there not be... accident.
You're a good lad, Dougie. A good lad, and I'm not denying it. You'll be a skipper one day.
Paul Douglas goes through it.
He went through it, aye.
Yeah.
So there was a space between here and the pier.
Yeah.
And the boat that came to get the cargo, which was all lying here.
Yeah.
Couldn't get in.
Right.
Drew too much water.
Yes.
To get in against the pier. He says, I'm sorry, the only thing I'll get is a buffer. So they had to put it all back on again.
You can't get your cargo out here and we draw too much to end by the wharf.
I know.
No, there's nothing can get at it except a buffer.
have you ever went another job then?
Oh. I didn't have any place for doing the job, mate. So we could have our plates put right. Why didn't you just let us sing the rocks? You might as well.
Thank you.
I was very pleased to do this.
Hope we meet you again.
If you ever want another job done. Goodbye, Mr. Marshall.
Goodbye, Mr. Marshall. Very
goodbye, Mr. Marshall. Marshall.
And good luck to you.
Thank you.